This is the Tom Anderson Show, broadcasting live from the KVNT studios, 7 to 9 a.m. Monday through Friday.
Alaska State Senator Shelley Hughes joins us. And Senator Hughes, Shelley, always a pleasure to have you with us. A lot of things happening in Juneau and in Alaska and on the national front. Are you keeping your wits about you as we come into a fourth month of the session?
Hey, good morning. Touching base with you and your listeners is what helps keep us grounded, because it is crazy. I admit it. It is crazy.
Well, one thing you and I talked about off air, we are friends off air, full disclosure, and you've been a client and we love you to death, but I want to see if you are interested in briefly talking about what happened with the Judiciary Committee and some frustration. We just heard from Senator Reinbold. She called in regarding driving to Canada and has arrived and is there and is somewhat, of course, dismayed at the Alaska Airlines mask prohibition for her to fly. I know you can't comment on that, but with regard to the Judiciary Committee, would you like to at least make a comment about that? Because she brought your name up in a video and narrative, and you and I are friends, and you said off air, hey, that's inaccurate what she said. I don't want to debate it with her and you, but do you have any comments in response to at least say that's not accurate publicly?
Well, actually, I do want to talk about all the drama in the last few days regarding Alaska Airlines. I think the most interesting thing, first of all, what beautiful weather and weekend, if you had to make the drive to Haines. This was the weekend of weekend to do it. I do think the most fascinating thing is the story that broke late last night that showed a flight from Dillingham where a pilot and a flight attendant, and I saw a photo that I don't believe was included in the article, but elsewhere on Facebook, that showed a passenger without mask. So you had a flight attendant without a mask, you had the pilot with the mask down below his chin, and a passenger without, and you know, the hypocrisy of that is pretty incredible. And as Ricky Ricardo used to tell Lucy, you got some splitting to do. That's what I would say to Alaska Airlines. And you know, Tom, I am just sick and tired of the mask and even the topic in the news and discussing it. I'm so tired of it. And, and it's at the point where if anybody, one of the inaccurate things that's been out there in the airwaves that somehow I want people to wear masks. You know, I personally, I'm pro-life, and I'm pro-life from the unborn in the womb all the way to an elderly person who might be health compromised. So I have no problem putting on a mask if it makes someone feel more comfortable, and I will do that. And I also believe that business, you know, can do no shirt, no shoes, no service kind of thing. I am concerned that you have, I think, businesses maybe running a little scared and doing some things in order not to get in trouble from the federal government, and that is concerning. But I'm just tired of the mask, and we here in the capital, we have, I believe, a 73% vaccinated. We of those that have reported, they've been vaccinated.
So you mean lawmakers and staffers, 73%, have been vaccinated in the Capitol. So that's a few hundred people. 73% is quite a bit.
Yes, and then you would have a handful that don't feel comfortable revealing that they've been vaccinated, so add a few percentage points for that. And then you can add a few more percentage points because there are people that have had COVID. And I don't care what CDC is saying. You talk to physicians privately, and if you have had COVID, your immunity is as strong, if not stronger, than a vaccination.
And you have a daughter that's a medical doctor. I remember when she graduated, and now she's practicing. By the way, what's her specialty?
She's doing family practice. She's raising little ones, so she's trying to keep her hours down while she's raising little ones. But yeah, so that we add all that, and we probably are at 80%. Easily 80%, immunity in the building, and yet we still have these crazy rules.
Well, let's get into it. We're talking with State Senator Shelley Hughes, but Shelley, I'm cutting you in because I really want to get, we only have so much time on the segment, and I got to ask, was it a heartfelt and difficult decision to extricate, to push Lora out of the chairmanship of Judiciary Committee? I know you are a friend of hers, your colleague, and my friend, our mutual friend, State Senator Mike Schauer is a friend of hers, and you guys have been in solidarity for many years. Was that a difficult one for you and your colleagues to say, hey, you're losing your chairmanship, at least temporarily?
Yes, absolutely was. And, you know, early in the session, as the complaints were coming in, several of us were working really hard to try to push back those that wanted to give her the boot and tried to work with her to figure out how we could make this work. In fact, we were the same group that fought for her to be brought into the caucus and to have the two highest-ranked Senate positions for the two matters that were of greatest concern to her. Number one was what was happening during the disaster declaration time. So we gave her the judiciary chair so she could work on those disaster steps. And secondly, she was really frustrated with the COVID policies in the building, and the highest ranking position for that was vice chair of Ledge Council, because we take turns with the House and the Senate alternating who chairs it. This year, the House member chairs it. And what I am frustrated with is I feel like we've moved backwards because some of the drama. I don't think Democratic Representative Sarah Hannon will be interested, for instance, in lifting the mask policy in the building because she's watched what's happened. So I feel like in some ways we've gone backwards, and, you know, we were rooting for Senator Reinbold to help us with softening those policies, and I'm afraid that they may be locked in at the end of the session. And by the way, what a lot of folks don't understand is, according to our state constitution, it states in black and white that the legislature shall adopt uniform rules. Those uniform rules and the statutes that we pass, and we are lawmakers, not lawbreakers, they give the legislative council the ability to set the rules in this building, workplace type rules. And so we have to vote to change that. And the uniforms rules also require decorum and respect on the floor and in committees. And then as an organization, we came together as Republicans with a mutual understanding and agreement that we would respect one another and not publicly disparage one another. So those are all the things that are in play. And I care very much about Senator Reinbold on the page with her on policy matters, you know, virtually across the board. There's a few sometimes differences. None of us have exactly the same, but she's part of the conservative our group, and if she, you know, we need her, basically. Otherwise, things move to the left. And that's a strange thing. Sometimes when there's, well, I wouldn't say sometimes. I would say when there's infighting with conservative, it actually shifts things to the left and takes us backwards. So all this drama with math basically taken us backwards as far as getting the COVID policy in
place. And some say it's a distraction from the state's business, and I would assume you'll concur with that. Majority Leader and State Senator Shelley Hughes with us. Now, one other thing tied to this, Senator Reinbold mentioned that she was passing efficiently bills through her Senate Judiciary Committee. Did you take exception to that? Because I know you listened to her interview with me. Did you and do your colleagues feel that there was a somewhat of an impasse through her committee? Or is she accurate that it was efficient in churning them out?
Well, you know, here she has the power to decide when and whether to set bills. There is just kind of an intuitive thing as conservatives, we want a spending cap, right? And there's an intuitive thing that we want to fix the PFD situation once and for all. And a personal legislation fixing the PFD, for instance, Senator Willa Cupp, all fine and good, and we might agree with the contents, but you don't want to use personal legislation for something like that because you put a comma in the wrong place and the legislator can pull it. That's why you want to use a governor's bill for something like that, because if you put a comma in there, the governor doesn't like it, he can't pull it. so that's State Senator Mike Schauer. He was very quick to get those bills moved out of his committee, State Affairs, and get them into that committee to work on them. So that's just kind of basic, and I know there were others that were comparing how many bills. I think Senator Schauer had gotten 14, 15 bills out in the same amount of time. I had someone tell me they reviewed back when I was judiciary, it was about the same amount by that date. So a person could argue, I'm not really worried about that, because if you had 15 bad bills, of course you wouldn't want to move them out.
State Senator Shelley Hughes talking about the fact that she and her colleagues, for the most part, want to get their agendas, legislation reviewed, debated, out or stopped, and move forward. Senator Hughes, Majority Leader Hughes, I have a question about your colleague L.V. Gray Jackson's anti-law enforcement bills, and there's quite a collection of them. What do you think, Planned Parenthood supporting Black Lives Matter groups, supporting at least one of them that I heard from some of the law enforcement advocacies? I know you can't speak for her, and I want to interview her at some point, but what's up with L.V. Gray Jackson? Why would she be so anti? I know she's African-American, but sheesh, is she going a bit too far with that collection of anti-cop bills?
Yeah, you know, I'm one who is fighting for Americans' individual liberty. I think things are threatened right now because of trendy, you know, woke kind of ideas and concepts, and that's turning into policy that's being pushed. And I'm not one just to flap my jaw about it. I'm one that gets my hands dirty and works with my colleagues on these things to preserve your constitutional rights, Tom, to stand up for people's liberty. And, you know, our laws and our government institutions, including our public schools, should be reflecting American values, Alaskan values. And some of the proposals right now, including the set that you're talking about, are incredibly concerning. The good news is we have the Republicans control the Senate, so I am not worried that we're going to put some kind of bad policy through in that area. I will say some of the bills are in my Community and Regional Affairs Committee, and I'm going to move them. I've been in touch with Senator Schauer, and he's going to take the whole package of law enforcement bills and be looking at them. So you're going to see probably a bill of Elvie's move out. I have some concerns. I'm going to make some amendments so it is least some of the stuff that is, I believe, promoting racism. I'm going to pull it out before I move it, but I'm not really going to work on it. It's State Affairs is the appropriate committee. If there's anything worthy or valuable in any of them, that'll be up to Senator Schauer. But yes, I have concerns, and I have concerns across the board. I saw a bill that one of the Democratic House members introduced regarding things to incorporate statewide in our public school curriculum, and I gagged when I saw it. And it's like, you know, it was about climate change and social emotional learning, and who knows, maybe critical race theory was in there. I don't know. It was a list of things, and I thought, goodness gracious, you know, seeing something so extreme as that, maybe I should introduce a bill that says we shall make it mandatory to incorporate Judeo-Christian values in our school curriculums. And to be perfectly honest, I think that's what Alaskans would prefer. Those are the American values, the Alaskan values that have made our country great, have made our state great. And it's not like there aren't flaws and we don't have areas where we can work, but we've got to stop this tide where we're trying to be a woke culture and a woke state. I'm going to stand, and you know, that's another thing. Part of what you have to have down here, you know it, is relationships, right? You have to be able to work to actually get things across the finish line. You can't just talk about them. You can't just say, I'm standing up and fighting for you and such. You actually have to be able to have the relationships and the ability to get through things and solutions put forward, proposals put forward to stop this craziness and get things across the finish line. And so some of us that work hard, but rather quietly, and we may not be in the headlines, we are the ones that are carrying these things and truly standing for people's liberties and putting our stake in the ground and saying, we're going to fight for your constitutional rights. We don't like the erosion that we see, and we're going to work to stop it.
Majority Leader Shelley Hughes is with us. You know, Alaska news source talking about Anchorage International Airport and it being the fourth busiest, most, it's all positive news from what I could read. Busiest cargo in terms of supply chain, in terms of traffic. I think of your colleague in the House, Representative Kevin McCabe, who's a senior captain, 747 pilot for Atlas Air Cargo. Mike Schauer, a FedEx pilot. You just talked about Senator Mike Schauer, who's a FedEx pilot flying for them cargo. Is that exciting to you to see positive news when we're on the map for good things, particularly with commerce and business?
Absolutely. And I am such a huge champion of opening up economic opportunities, pulling back restrictions. That's part of what we're to look out for that. And I'm excited. One of the things we're working on to get across the finish line, we're fast tracking it, is a message to our federal delegation and those in Congress regarding broadband, because when we see the opportunities and how important the internet is in areas where it's strong and it has good speeds, it has positive impacts on commerce. It has positive impact on people able to have good jobs. It has positive impact on healthcare delivery, you know, at a lower cost, and education at a lower cost. And so that's something, you know, I don't like the federal debt. I'm really super concerned our great-great-grandkids are going to bear it. I think we're approaching $28 trillion, but with all the other unfunded liabilities, it's up well over $100 trillion, and it's a travesty. But I tell you, if they're going to pass an infrastructure bill later this summer or whenever they do it, it needs to include the information highway, not just the roads, bridges, and ports. And if whatever they put in for broadband, it needs to work for Alaska because of our unique challenges, our vast distances, the variety of terrain that we have crossing, you know, mountains and rivers and tundra. So we want to make sure that anything coming out of that will work for us, because that is going to be important for our economic growth and stability, which is what passing more bills and bigger government does not make for a vibrant society. It is economic growth. So I'm very passionate about that. I've also got a hemp bill that I'm excited about because it removes the pilot program. So now if someone wants to invest in a large hemp ag farm, they don't have to worry about, oh, wow, this might go away. So we've got a bill that basically, because the federal law is changing, we can get rid of the temporary program. There's a third one that's really important to economic growth and stability for families and businesses, and that's my Right to Shop Act, and it pertains to health care. And there's misinformation out there. There is a database bill that is out there that has zero patient information, zero names, zero communities, zero birth date, social security name. It's just going to be an accumulation of various prices for various procedures and medications, so we can see how much are entities charging for insulin in this state. What does it cost in this state for a knee procedure? What does it cost for a 15-minute primary care visit? It's just data, so we get a handle. The healthcare industry pricing has been cloaked in a bit of secrecy, and the free market principles are not operating. And the reason I tell you that, because I've heard rumors out there, this database is going to be all about taking away our guns. Well, it is. It will not be. It will have no identifying information. It's going to come from the insurance companies who currently have those databases. And I tell you, if they accidentally released patient information, oh my gosh, would they be sued up the yin-yang by millions of dollars by every single Alaskan. So that database is necessary. And the reason I tell you, because that database is going through right now a bill to allow that de-identified database, and it pairs up with my right to shop bill, because my right to shop bill would allow you to go on to your insurance company's website and use a price comparison tool, an online price comparison tool. And if you chose a provider for a certain procedure that was less than the average cost in the network, you would get a savings check back. You would get part of it. So it's to incentivize you. So if you pick something that's $2,000 less, that $2,000 would be shared, that savings, you'd get a check for part of it. Your employer would get a check for part of it, and the insurance company would retain a part.
So you're on to something there. I tell you, I appreciate your quick wit and your courage to push some of these bills and help Alaskans. State Senator Shelley Hughes, Majority Leader Shelley Hughes, thank you for joining us. As always, we're going to make a video out of this one, Tom Anderson Show.